An issue that has come back into limelight because there is a case going on in Supreme Court about it is the amendments the central government brought in to the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act, the FCRA Act. The FCRA Act, as the name suggests, deals with regulating the foreign donations, money, funds that come in from foreign entities to Indian entities. And it's to do with tracking those, regulating those, giving permissions to who can get this money, where can it go, and all of that. Now, the government went about making some changes to these regulations, and those have now been challenged in the Supreme Court. There are, I think, three different petitions in the Supreme Court demanding a relook into the foreign funding rule amendments that the government has made. The FCRA Act, by the way, if let me tell you, was first enacted in 1976. And then it was amended in 2010, when a slew of measures were taken by the government at that time to regulate foreign donations. The FCRA 2010 has already since then been amended three times, various aspects on it. But what is the larger argument which is in play here? The argument from one side is that the government is using and making these changes to tighten regulations and make it more difficult for grassroots NGOs, non-government organizations who are working in various remote parts of the country for various upliftment of communities, helping the poor, helping the tribals, for all different kinds of good charity work. The government is making these changes to make it more difficult for these NGOs to get the money from the bigger groups, and hence drying up their funding. That's essentially the argument. The government only says we need systems and tighter systems to ensure that we're able to track the money. And you as an entity, if you're getting money from a foreign donor, you should be using that money, not channeling it ahead, because that's how then the money moves in directions where it cannot be tracked. So if it's coming for a purpose, it should be used for that purpose. So here is the debate. We are only doing what is right legally to regulate foreign money which is coming into these entities. And the other side saying, no, all you're actually doing is choking us and choking the NGOs who are doing some good work and blocking the fund which is required for us to function. This debate is back in the limelight because the government is vociferously now defending these amendments in the Supreme Court. Is there merit to what the NGOs are saying? Has perhaps, you know, lack of funding really impacted their business, their work that they're doing, their operations? And if so, can we really look at a situation where the government here and there does need the help of grassroots NGOs? And if they don't get that, is that a good thing? More importantly, if political parties can continue to get foreign funds, get endless, without any limit, corporate funds, foreign funds, and get them anonymously, then why is the same government that made those rules enabling political parties to get foreign funds so averse to the NGOs getting it? I say good evening to Sudesh Sharma, spokesperson for the BJP, Ashish Dikshit, advocate with the Supreme Court, Sanjay Hegde, senior advocate with the Supreme Court, and Flavia Agnes, co-founder for Majlis, joining me this evening. Flavia, I want to start off with you to get a sense of why is there so much of aversion to these changes that are being made? Flavia Agnes, the question to you.
Who is this question for?
Yes, to you.
Oh, for me. Okay. I thought it was for somebody else. Yeah, I'm a founder member of this organization, Majlis. And the main aim of this organization is to provide litigation support and legal advocacy to women who are battered. And also children and women who are sexually abused. Now, this is a very grassroots world. And today, if you see in our country that for sexual abuse, there is no support person. The government is not providing that very necessary support from the time an FIR is filed till the case goes to court to help this young child who is being sexually abused at every stage so that convictions actually happen. Or the implementation of the Domestic Violence Act, which was passed in 2005. And here, still there are so many obstacles here. So now when you're doing this kind of very grassroots work and reaching out to vulnerable women and children and whatever donor agencies, the providers, if the government brings such regulations, it's not just we're not transferring the grant to somebody else onwards at all. But it is a way the government is choking up all NGOs and making it impossible to function, because every day there are new rules, new regulations, new demands to, like, every 3 months account for this money, how much you have received, how much you spent, where it is gone, etc. So the NGOs are busy doing this administrative work and they have no time to do actually the project work. And this is what has been happening to many NGOs. And also here, the government's, in a way, fear is there are a lot of Christian NGOs running schools, who are running schools in tribal areas, rural areas, etc., providing healthcare facilities, etc. And if they don't get the grant, they will not be able to function. So this kind of regulations that are being brought in a way, choking all NGOs and making them impossible to function under this regime. And this has been happening, you've seen, from 2014 onwards, step by step, every day they're bringing in new rules. And it's not possible to function. And I'm glad that somebody has brought it up at the Supreme Court, and at least the Supreme Court can look at it and examine it and see exactly what is the situation on the ground.
You know, what you pointed out, and that's so important for us to understand as a fallout of when we take steps like this, where, you know, smaller NGOs struggle, are completely choking in far-flung areas, in rural areas, where they are actually the frontline workers helping people in places where government healthcare can't properly reach. It's these NGOs who take it around. And I think the pandemic itself was a, you know, big example that showed us that we need them. We need them on ground. We need them to convince people that taking a vaccine is good for them, that they shouldn't run away for it. We needed them to spread awareness about it. And if we start to choke them, then it's a problem. But is that what is the intent? Mr. Sudesh Verma, please explain to us why these changes are necessary.
These changes are not there to harass anyone. I disagree with the perception being created. This is simply to bring better compliance of the legal system which the country has devised. And we do strongly feel that certain provisions, if you want, I can enumerate. Like, you know, that you cannot transfer your funding for the simple reason that, you know, if you go on transferring the funding, and you see, there used to be earlier 50% you can spend on administrative expenses. Now it has come to 20%. Just imagine that if somebody is getting 100 crore as donation, and then he is able to transfer, say, 50% to the fund, because 50% he can show as administrative expenses, then the other NGO out of 50 crore will transfer 25 crore. In that way, if you go on transferring from one NGO to other, and every NGO spends 50% in administrative expenses, it becomes a very, very ridiculous exercise. So now the issue is that you can take donations, you are registered for a specific purpose, and that purpose must be enumerated, why you have taken the fund, who is giving you the fund. It is for greater transparency, and why should anyone oppose it? You see, asking for Aadhaar card of those who are running the NGOs is something that should bring better compliance, isn't it? So why should people worry about it? When we asked Amnesty, what was Amnesty doing here, do you recall? They were just trying to create private entities because they were not allowed FCRA. They took in the form of FDI money here, and they were using that money. They were transgressing the Indian laws. So they shut their shops here. So the issue is, see, you, of course, government has recognized, and it has told in the court also, that yes, we do recognize the role of these NGOs. But at the same time, if you're taking foreign funding, you must comply with the legal system that is there. And nobody should...
I completely agree with you, Mr. Verma. I don't think the debate is about people who are flouting norms and breaking the law. The debate is about the merit of the law itself, and the changes that you brought into the law, and whether that is badly impacting the NGOs. Obviously, if somebody decides to not follow the rule of the law, and you're able to prove that, then by all means shut them down, or they can exit if they run out of money. But the problem is, if you're going to bring in laws which make it very difficult for even entities like Majlis to function, then what's the point of it?
So, Tanvi, There has to be a system under which everyone has to function. If the system is discriminatory, then we can understand that if you are making an issue. You see, how many NGOs are, let's get the facts correct first. According to the statement given in the Lok Sabha, 22,400 NGOs are registered under FCRA. Out of that, 20,600 were deregistered because they were not complying with the FCRA legislation. You see, and it's not that only this government has, and it began from 2011 onwards. Amnesty was deregistered when the UPA was in power. Do you know it? In 2010.
Yes.
And then 2012, against this, they started operation. So you see, you can talk of vendetta when there is discrimination. There is no discrimination. Law is for everyone. Well, why don't you follow the law?
Just because an entity like Amnesty and Amnesty International, Amnesty India, faced or took on both governments, yours and the previous, doesn't mean that there is no discrimination against them. That's a long-standing practice of certain entities taking on what governments are doing and having their stand on human rights and everything else. But I don't want to make this debate about amnesty. It's not. We're talking about a larger set of rules that must exist for the thousands of NGOs which are functional here and registered here. And there, Mr. Sanjay Hegde, are these rules to enable governments to track the money better? The rule that Sudesh Verma cited says, if you're getting money, you use the money. Why are you passing out on to 15 other entities? Because that's where the problem really begins of what your motive is. Well, what is your view on that aspect?
Let's put it this way, that the FCRA was one of the worst contributions of the emergency era. Indira Gandhi had a particular phobia about the CIA destabilizing her, and that was when the FCRA came about. Thereafter, it has become a useful tool for governments which either are relaxed norms or they tighten it very much. Now, the question is, where do these rules stand, or what is the purpose? Sudesh Verma says that no, only one particular organization should handle money which comes from abroad. Please look at it like a big donor foundation like the Ford Foundation or the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. They decide that we are going to allocate so many million dollars for girls' education. Now, girls' education in India. They would like to have one organization with which they can transact. That organization in turn could take care of activities all over India through a whole host of NGOs. That is no longer possible because you can't expect the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to say, okay, which is the best NGO to do this job in Jumri Talaiya? You can't expect the Ford Foundation to say, where in Tirunelveli can we get an NGO which deals with women's menstrual issues? Local intelligence, NGOs are also as much about management, as much about corporate structures as anything else. This is like saying that, you know, if you have a company which gets a contract, it cannot subcontract further, no matter what. There are certain companies which specialize. You want a bridge built. There will be a company which specializes in metal rivets, another in screws. If you can't work further, then you might as well stop building that bridge. This is the action of a government, which is typical of many governments around the world. In fact, the relative ease with which amnesty works in any country is often seen as an index of freedom in that country itself. Amnesty International launched an Indian version specifically for this. They used only Indian funds. There were many contributors, including Infosys. They had money coming from abroad, which they kept in a fixed deposit, and against that, they took a loan. Mm. But this government seems to have a problem even with that. And yes, what this government essentially is doing is by 1,000 cuts to every NGO which they do not like. They keep forgetting that they are a byproduct of the biggest NGO in India, the RSS. Does anybody look after how much money comes in there?
political parties by themselves, not even the RSS, Mr. Hegde, but the political parties can freely get foreign funds, all kinds of anonymous corporate donor funds, and no questions asked there. In fact, they changed that not only to benefit themselves in the future, but also get out of legal trouble about when political parties broke the same rule and got foreign funds back in the early 2000s. Mr. Sudesh Varma, so mighty convenient to change the rules when you want the money, but not when the NGOs want it.
No, not the reality, but let me first make the record straight on amnesty. It's a very sensitive issue.
Yes.
He has tried to put it in a different light. Amnesty had opened a private limited company,
yes,
called Amnesty International India Private Limited. An NGO is not supposed to open such a company because Amnesty was not allowed to get money under FCRA. They took through FDI route, which was illegal. Okay,
yes.
FDI route came from Amnesty UK and 36 crore came and they were not ready to give account. And when it was asked, they said they flouted the norm. When they were asked why did they do so, they chose to close their shop. So you cannot violate the law of the country because you think you are a supranational organization. It hurts my sovereignty. It hurts my dignity as an Indian. And you have to follow the Indian law made by Parliament, as simple as that. I don't know how it can be defended. I can talk of every amendment made in the 2010 FCRA Act under the September 2020 Act, which is the new law now. We are saying that give your Aadhaar card. We need Aadhaar card because we want to know who are the person running the NGO. We are saying that administrative expenses cannot be more than 50%, cannot be more than 20%. We have brought it down from 50 to 20%. So which means that money will go to the target beneficiaries. And Melinda Gates and Bill Gates, they know quite well, you know, that what kind of NGOs are there. They can give directly to those NGOs. There are, as I gave the figure.
Okay.
There are 22,400 NGOs registered under FCRA.
Fair enough. Mr. Sudesh Sharma, like I reiterated earlier also, I'm highlighting this again. If any company, be it Amnesty, also breaks the law of the land, fair enough. That's fine. But then the same benchmark should also apply to the BJP and the Congress, who broke the same law of the land under FCRA, under Foreign Contribution Regulatory Act, by getting foreign donations from two big international corporate entities when it was not allowed. And when it was, this matter reached the court, is when your government brought in an amendment to retrospectively allow political parties to get foreign funds. So, my question again, mighty convenient to retrospectively change the law of the land to suit yourself, get it passed in the parliament. Even the opposition won't oppose you on this one because it helps them as well. But then you cite the law for others?
Tanvi, do you know the categories of people who are not allowed to take foreign donations? It includes political candidates, political parties, even public servants. We have added public servant. And you know why it has been done? Because public servant can always misuse authority.
Yes.
Misuse authority and run NGOs in the name of wife or, husband or son or daughter.
Yes.
Or in the name of other people, get money through a different route and cheat the whole system. So now public servant is a broader category that has also been brought into the system now.
Okay. Let me bring it. Fair enough. Yes, that is a new clause under the FCRA amendments that doesn't allow public servants, NGOs, to get any money. I understand the concept behind that. Ashish Dikshit, thank you for patiently waiting. But the debate really here is about the changes and the impact on those changes, whether it benefits our system or harms our system.
Good evening, Tanvi, and good evening to everyone. No one can deny the contributions which NGO makes in the daily life, and they reach out to help people in the places where real help is needed. And what I have noticed that most of the NGOs also advise the government and the policymakers to be, you know, little transparent in their services and in their actions. But when the government is asking them to be transparent by introducing these kind of amendments, there is an opposition by few of the NGOs highlighting that it is going to interfere in the functioning. Whereas if you only see a regulation doesn't necessarily mean that it is going to hamper your services. You may say that, yes, there will be an added obligation on us to get all these legal formalities done. But if you look at the intent under which these amendments are made, these are under the intent of having more transparency into the functioning of NGO. Now, I believe there is only one amendment which the most of the NGOs would be objecting, is that they have to give the accounts under which the foreign contribution which they have received, how they have spent that money. Otherwise, having a condition like giving your Aadhaar numbers and Aadhaar numbers of the people who are running the NGO, I don't think these are something very, very, you know, this is a trivial matter. But if you look at the advantage of giving Aadhaar number, we had several debates where I participated in which Aadhaar issue was debated, and there was many cons were they were highlighted by many of the members who were opposing the Aadhaar policy. But if you see, because you gave the example of pandemic, you see during the pandemic when the vaccination had to be done, the entire Aadhaar system came to the help of the government, and because of the Aadhaar, the process got streamlined. So yes, when there are policy changes, of course, it takes time. It gives some little inconvenience, but if we compare it to the larger policy of the government to bring in transparency, I think this is a welcome step. And most important part is that this is a policy matter of the government, totally in the domain of the parliament and the government. So if an amendment is made, the only legal challenge can be that the parliament did not have the legal competence, or it directly affects the fundamental right of any individual, which in my opinion, reading the pleadings, it is a little difficult to say that you have a fundamental right to directly receive foreign money and give no accounts for. So in all these circumstances, I think...
Sorry, I didn't understand that. You're saying that if a parliament has enacted some law, challenge is if we say that it's against my fundamental rights?
Or there was legislative incompetence. There are two, three grounds under which these can be challenged. So, and that is what the grounds which are taken in the writ petition.
Yeah.
But the difficulty comes that for an NGO to say that I have a fundamental right to receive foreign contribution, that may be so. But you cannot say that I have a fundamental right not to disclose how much is the contribution and how much has been spent. Because the government
has to also raised
take
this
care
point
of the internal policy of the government.
Yes, if I may just ask Flavia Agnes to come in here, because she's the one who's actually experiencing it via her organization. Is the problem that you don't want to tell the government where you're spending money, or that the entire process has just been made so tedious and difficult to get the funds?
It's become extremely tedious to get the funds. There are such controls and regulations. Nobody's saying they should not be. But in a small NGO, spending so much time and energy, not on the work they want to do, but in all these administrative regulations and tasks. You, every 3 months, you file the report, you have the account in a particular bank, you have to have this kind of permission. It's all the time you're only doing this, and you're caught in it. And Madhvis is, in that sense, is urban. It's a relatively has got a certain infrastructure. What about small groups in smaller towns? What about rural groups? How are they going to cope with it? All these regulations that if you don't file within this, your contribution will be stopped. I mean, everybody who takes foreign funds is a suspect today, that you are all the time watched over as if you are getting funds for some terrorist activity or something like that. All the time you have to prove yourself, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing conversions, I'm not putting the money somewhere else. I mean, this kind of inquiry makes you that you're doing some illegal activity. And this was not the case earlier. It is now today from 2014-15 onwards, we are experiencing this. And a lot of NGOs have been de-recognized under FCRA. In fact, more than 1,000 have been de-registered. And there's always a constant surveillance. I mean, you raid whoever is doing human rights work, you raid their organization. You try to do badnam for them. I mean, Lawyers Collective was raided, Harshmandir was raided. You see all these people doing good work, and you find some fault in their accounting. You can't blame them for their work, but you put some allegations out to them of funds irregularity. That is the most scary part of it, that each of us become a suspect. At any point, the government can move, and even something, some minor thing is there, you can say that you have violating FCRA norms.
And let me just say this, you know, why is it that what you're raising is such a big issue? Because I know that the argument from the other side will be, but if you've done nothing wrong, then what is the problem in however many times you have to offer the explanation? It's just that this level of harassment can lead to people getting discouraged from doing the work. If I'm going to be starved for funds due to these laws and I have to run around to try and get them and I don't, I am someday going to give up on this and just walk away. How is that beneficial? Mr. Sudesh Sharma, to you, and then Sanjay Hegde wants to come in.
I just want to add one small point here.
Yes.
And now today, nobody wants to be a trustee of an NGO. People are just scared of being trustees of the NGO because they are scrutinized to such an extent that when we ask somebody like our trustee, Justice Suresh passed away, we wanted a new trustee, and we asked so many people, they said, no, we don't want to come under the government scrutiny and government surveillance because there is a board, there is trust, and there is an organization and there are activities. The people who are doing the activities are committed. We bring this board in here to support us. But they said, no, we don't want to come under the government scrutiny to this extent.
Okay, so let Sudesh Sharma respond to that. Mr. Sudesh Sharma, for a few bad apples that are there, nobody denies that fact. Are you ending up destroying the whole system?
No, not at all, Tanvi. My argument is your argument as well, what you said, that in the interest of transparency, because you see, it's not a job which NGO people are doing, you know. They're doing service to mankind, isn't it? So you need to be more transparent in the funds you receive, how you have spent, and you have nothing to hide. Why should you worry? Now that the entire country is going digital, it's much easier, you know. The same argument you was used when GST was being implemented. There would be hiccups here and there would be problems, but at the same time, you would learn to live with it, you know, and that is how the country goes. Because nobody, you can single out, you can say that you are being singled out when actually you can point out to discrimination. It's for everyone who's receiving fund. So why should you worry about it? And you should not be bothered. You have taken fund from someone for something. If you are acting according to the mandate, you should not be worried. If the government tries to fix you, there are courts, systems which can take care of you.
Yes, so I that's exactly what I said, because I knew this will be the argument from the other side. In the interest of transparency, if you've done nothing wrong, then what is to fear? Mr. Sanjay Hegde.
The classic answer is, if I'm going to be questioned, then why should I do anything? That's exactly how the bureaucracy in this country functions.
Don't do anything in this country.
Now don't interrupt me. It's exactly how you've run down the bureaucracy also, because the moment you tend to say, explain this, that, after 10 years, 15 years, and otherwise I will raid you, people will say, look, I just don't want to get into this. And Flavia is not wrong about many people, respected people, former judges, senior advocates. You ask them, sir, this is NGO, we've been doing all this so far, etc. We would like you to be on our oversight board, and everybody will sweetly smile and say, you know, I'm very busy these days. I don't think I can give time to it. Because the answer is very simple. Wants these inspectors continually on your back and then to be yelled at through the IT cell network and through media channels that there was 600 rupees missing, which this gentleman spent on a bottle of wine. This is the kind of action which has happened. And I was just doing some arithmetic about Sudesh Verma's figures that of about 24,000 NGOs, I think he said, 22,000 got deregistered. That means only 2,000 remain.
400 is the statement in Lok Sabha.
So how many remain?
And 20,600 brought out of FCRA deregistered because they were not following the norms.
Yes.
There are
government. 2,000 NGOs left in this country which want FCRA. That's what you've done to the sector. Congratulations.
Let me tell you, Tanvi, I'm surprised that what kind of arguments being given, but at the same time.
No, so I think, you know, Mr. Sudesh Sharma, I know where you're coming from. You're saying if they were illegal, they're illegal. They have to be deregistered. Why are you backing them? It brings me back to the point that if you make, a law, if you design a law in such a way that 80%, 90% of them do end up, getting into trouble, then you are not benefiting the sector, which is where you need to look into. There may be definitely a few people, a few bad apples, there will be definitely some NGOs who, in the name of good work and charity work, are actually following their own agenda, are actually targeting government for vested interests, or are actually being used by entities to channel the money, to move the money from one part to the other via multiple entities for other purposes, nothing to do with the good work they're doing. Yes, those entities exist in every part of this world and must be cracked down upon. But to say that we will bring in a system that chokes everybody, and especially the smaller ones, the ones in far-flung areas doing the actual good work, how does that serve anybody's purpose? That is what we have to look at and think about. And I think if the government really does want and wants to stand with the NGOs, then the government will find ways to help them out and look at the changes that need to be made. Thank you so much for joining us on this conversation.